Many of them left jobs. They left loved ones.
Wait a minute. Peace to my wife. I love you. You complete me.
The thing I love about the XFL is the heart and soul that these players show.
Oh, yeah.
For the love of the game, of playing football, and the opportunity of continuing to play the game they love here in the XFL.
A lot of you tuned into the XFL the first week. Unfortunately, most of you never came back. Well, we listened to you, and we've made the rule changes to give you what you really want. So come back. At halftime, we'll take you into the cheerleaders' locker room.
I would like to introduce all of you ladies to the one man that's going to be privileged enough to walk into your locker room with a camera. And here he is. His name is Bruno. Say hi to the girls, Bruno.
Hi, girls.
Hi, Bruno.
Have fun.
Here now, Vince McMahon. Thanks for coming, Vince.
Pleasure.
XFL ratings are down 75% from week one. They now rival the lowest ratings ever in primetime, not just for a sports program, but for any television show.
Right.
Can you guarantee me right now that there will be a year two for the XFL?
Can I guarantee you that? I can't guarantee you that I'm going to be breathing in and breathing out after we leave this studio.
But you're pretty sure about that one.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure about the continuation of the XFL in one form or another.
Does that mean on network television and on NBC in year two?
I would like to say so, yes. NBC has been very supportive. I think that the difference here, Bob, is that people have to understand that when you start a league like this, I mean, this is not the easiest thing to do. I mean, let's face it. So when you start a league like this, even though we have many advantages, it's not easy. You make mistakes along the way. You correct your mistakes. You focus. And you go forward in terms of brand building. And this is brand building. This is not just television programming. And that's a thing I think that a lot of people, quite frankly, miss. I mean, it's all about, you know, the 13 weeks and out or less in terms of television programming these days, especially with the attention span of a lot of the programmers on the network. So, I mean, again, I think that once the affiliates understand that this is brand building, I think we're in it for the long run with NBC is certainly my hope, and they've given me every indication that that is the case.
You know, it's one thing to try to build a brand on cable or elsewhere, but even on Saturday night, which has not been the best night for the networks in recent years, that airtime is meaningful, it's important, and it can't be sacrificed week after week if some improvement isn't shown. That's just common sense, right? Significant improvement.
Well, you know, certainly I don't think anything is going to be sacrificed. At the same time, again, I think there has to be a longer range approach, that this is not just programming. We're in it for the long run. I'm very long range oriented in everything that we do business wise. So, I mean, I think that once the affiliates catch on to that, you know, and stay with it, I think we have to make a marked improvement in our television ratings. And quite frankly, I'm disappointed in them, no doubt about that. You know, I think that, you know, we started out with this huge television rating and dropped off, you know.
Curiosity factor, promos leading up.
I think it was curiosity factor, but I think we made some mistakes as well. I mean,
what were the biggest mistakes, and what can you correct, or is it too late in some cases because people have gone away?
I don't think it's too late. I think that, you know, the caliber of the play initially was not as good as it should be. The caliber of play now is fantastic. It's great.
It's the same players by and large. How in the space of a month can the caliber of play improve that much?
It's real easy because, you know, we didn't have the luxury of starting, you know, a 4-week preseason like the NFL normally does. Again, this is a startup league, Bob. You got to give us a little bit of a break here, and the media does as well, because we knew we were going to make mistakes, and we have made them. So had we started up in a longer preseason, then the teams would have been far more cohesive. You know, they would have looked much more like NFL football, though we said all along this is not NFL football. So I think the caliber of the play now is extraordinary. It's exciting. You've got wide open offenses now, and, you know, and a lot of points are going up on the board. You've got, you know, innovations which we have made, and quite frankly, some of the network execs, you know, that cover the NFL are already talking about stealing them.
You mean audio and having the cameraman on the field and a different point of view, that sort of thing, different production techniques.
Right. I think they'd actually steal the scramble if they could. You know, I mean, that's kind of
instead of the coin toss.
Right. You know, we call it the human coin toss. You know, so the idea here is to start up a league in which players have opportunity, otherwise would not have an opportunity. It's a very family-friendly in terms of ticket prices. You know, we've been averaging some 27,000 people coming to our live events, which I would suggest would rival, if not supersede, what the old AFL did when they first started, and even the NFL. Let's look at this realistically. The NFL has been at this for 75 years. You know, it's not fair, you know, to jump all over us and, okay, when are you guys going to die? Is it over yet? You know, can it please be over yet, you know? You know, 75 years of building a brand, you know, and the NFL is where they are now, more power to them. I think they do some things wrong that we do right, and I think that it's going to take a little time to build our brand, and you can't do it in 1 year's time. It's unrealistic for anyone who wants to partner with us to think that you can build a brand in 1 year.
What about this analysis, which seems pretty much on the money to me? It's not WWF enough for that crowd,
right,
and it's got not good enough football for the sports-minded crowd. It's neither fish nor fowl. People took a look, and they split.
I don't think, you know, again, I think that that's not necessarily unfair, what you just said. I think our research indicates that the World Wrestling Federation fan likes his diet of WWF entertainment in its proper form. I think that in terms of a football fan standpoint, they like football. I don't think that they mind any of the rule changes that we've made, you know, any of our brand of football and bringing the game closer to the fan. The in-stadium experience is off the chart when you come to an XFL game. It's off the chart. You're really almost on the field. You feel so close to the play. So these innovations are fantastic. I think that again, the caliber of the play more than anything else, we weren't quite ready to play the kind of ball that we are currently playing. And it's my hope that, you know, that the media, you know, which has been, I think, somewhat unfair, you know, in jumping all over us and asking for this damn thing to please go away. You know, I think it's unfair when you consider the caliber of play that we have now. All I'm asking is just take another look at it now and judge it on its merit or lack of merit as it relates to football.
You came to this with plenty of power, with expertise from a certain area of television and entertainment. Mm-hmm. You came to it with celebrity, but in most people's minds, not with prestige because of the type of programming you're associated with. On the other hand, NBC has prestige. Right. They risk not just dollars, they risked prestige. Do you think, is your sense as you deal with the people at NBC, that they're feeling the heat on that front?
Oh, I think they're feeling the heat. I mean, again, I think that the media made certain that they're feeling the heat. You know, I mean, they're asking Ebersol, you know, please get the hell out of this thing, you know. And Dick is very a stand-up guy and a friend of mine, as you know, for many, many years. Bob Wright as well. I think that they're in this thing with us, but at the same time, I don't know how much heat they can take, and I don't know what prestige means anymore, because again, when you think about brand building, I don't think the XFL has hurt NBC in terms of prestige. How? Because they've been associated with me individually, or, you know, the smear, if you would, of World Wrestling Federation Entertainment? I mean, is that it?
I think there's a general perception that while the XFL doesn't go anywhere near where the WWF goes, that it's a low-rent form of television.
Have you seen any of the games? Tell me what is low-rent.
Not so much within the games. The pregame show, especially week one,
we don't have
was one of the most mindless things I've ever seen.
We don't have a pregame show.
Week one, there was a pregame show.
We don't have any pregame shows, which is one of
anymore?
Our problems. No, we've never had a pregame show.
What was the
show?
Pregame show that aired in Los Angeles, in New York, and in other markets a half hour prior to the first game?
A local thing that the NBC O&Os put together, of which we had nothing to do with.
But it left the impression in many quarters that this was a low-rent deal. And I'm sure that NBC is hearing it from affiliates, from station managers, and from some portion of the audience saying not just that we don't like this, so we prefer to watch something else, but that we're offended by this association.
Well, you know, if that's the case, you know, then they have to do what they have to do, and just like you do, Bob, you know? I mean, quite frankly, from my standpoint, I'm an entrepreneur. I'm what makes this company, I'm what makes my company and this country go round and round. I take risk, calculated risk. And quite frankly, if you'll go back to when we first made this announcement of the XFL, we didn't have any partners. We were going to do it all on our own, okay? So I think it is a viable business. I think that that when you come to a live event and you see all these young people in the stands having a wonderful time, I think that our television ratings are going to build back. I think that we may throw a few things in there to get them back in terms of promotions and things of that nature. And we're going to have to do that. We're going to have to spend some money, you know, that we otherwise may not have to spend. We're going to have to convince the media, quite frankly, to cover this for the event that it is, not the perception that you, as an elitist in my point of view, or others would have about it ain't low rent football. I'm sorry. It's kids out there playing their hearts out if you've watched it.
No one dismisses the players and coaches who are trying to make a living in a football league. No one dismisses that, and there are probably very good stories within that. There is an association, though, that in the minds of some is a plus. That's what brought a lot of that 10 rating the first week. People saying, well, I'll take a look at what Vince McMahon has cooked up, and I saw the promos. There are others who are put off by that. You bring both positives and negatives.
Who's put off? And in what way? What have we done in anything with the XFL? What, we have cheerleaders? We said right out front we were going to have cheerleaders, nice-looking ladies that you were going to get to know, unlike the NFL, sort of has them but doesn't have them kind of a thing. If nothing else, we are brutally honest about who we are and what we are presenting. But there isn't one thing in that game that I know of that we've presented that's salacious in any way.
If the ratings don't turn around, will you be tempted to make it more salacious?
No, we just did that. You know, we just did, as a matter of fact, you showed the clip at the top, you know, of some sort of thing whereby we were going to go into the Orlando Rage cheerleaders locker room. Okay?
Right.
It was a spoof, all right? And
the guy hit his head, couldn't get inside, and
right.
You tried to revive him as he lay there in the corner.
Right, and we said it was a blatant attempt to increase television ratings. As promos all week long, that's what we said. And it was, you know, but we were winking at our audience. They understand what we're doing. And I believe it's the quality of the football that's going to bring viewers back.
If you could be guaranteed that it would increase ratings, would you fix the games?
What a ridiculous statement.
It's not a statement. It's a question.
It's a question. I beg your pardon. It's a question. No. It's either football or it's not. Now, if it's entertainment, then no different than I did, you know, a long time ago, you know, when my predecessors tried to pawn off that wrestling was sport years ago. You know, I mean, that's absurd.
And you came out and said it's sports entertainment and
it's entertainment.
The matches are staged.
Right, absolutely. So how could you possibly script a football game? You know, boy, you're giving me credit for a lot of talent that I don't think I have, okay? I mean, you have to catch the ball. You have to run with the ball. You can't script football.
And isn't
frankly,
that really part of the problem?
Well,
because there's a whole lot of football on TV.
Right.
There's the NFL, and it has a long season, and all the college games.
Right.
And you have the World League in Europe, or the NFL Europe, I guess it's called. And if people just wanted to see football, they could pipe in Canadian Football League games. So if you can't do something significantly different at the edges, what's the real incentive to watch these games?
Well, the real incentive to watch the game is because it's the best football other than NFL you can possibly watch. It's not, you know, European ball. You know, it's not college ball. This is great football, and we didn't show that in our first several weeks. We also had some production problems, things of that nature. We also had the wrong announcers out there. You know, I mean, that's part of our problem as well. We've corrected production. We've corrected announcers as we're going forward.
Are WWF announcers the right announcers for football?
No, they're not. No, they're not the right
announcers.
Will
you be able to get top-flight announcers? Because I know within the business, and this is not from people necessarily who wish you ill, but within the business...
Well, I'm sure there's no one who wishes me ill.
Well, I'm sure there are many people who do, but I think some objective people...
And why would they wish me ill?
People,
tell me, why did they want to wish me ill?
The show's only an hour long. There are many people, we'll get to it in a minute, who consider what you've done on the WWF, while successful, to be objectionable. We'll get to that in a minute. A lot of first-rate announcers are reluctant to be involved in this type of programming because they feel that it carries a stigma.
Well,
that it's not something that would look good on their resume. On the other hand, some established guys have done it,
right,
but many have backed away or would have no interest. So my question to you is, if you've got to get what you call the right announcers in there, what's your talent pool for that?
We'll have to create talent. Talent's out there. You have to go find it.
You call yourself a risk taker.
Right.
You have been that.
Right.
If this turns out to be a grand-scale failure. Mm-hmm. What impact will that have on you?
Well, you know, I get knocked on my keister, I dust myself off,